It's amazing to hear those stories. Hearing missionary stories and what's happening around the country should encourage you greatly. I've learned that hope for Christians is different than the hope that the world offers. Hope for us is no longer a passion for what is possible, but hope for Christians is believing the promises of God. Hope is no longer a passion for what can be possible. Anyone can have hope. People hope for things to change in their jobs. People hope for things to change at home or with their kids. People hope for all sorts of things. You can hope for behavior to be modified, for circumstances to change. But for us as believers, it isn't just about hoping for what is possible. Stories like what's happening in Africa, what's happening in the lives of people in this church, should tell you the story that the Christian hope is so much greater than just longing for possibilities. True Christian hope is passionate about the promises of God, so much so that we take our whole life and we stake it upon these promises. I don't have hope, made up hope. I don't have fragile hope. I don't have circumstantial hope. I don't have hope that's frail. I have everlasting hope because the promises my God has made, I know he will always fulfill. Today, I've entitled the message, Here for Hope. I want to talk about how Jesus Christ came so that you and I may have hope. I want us to spend some time encountering Jesus as he moves from the desert into the Samaria hills as he makes his way up to Galilee. I want us to go to Israel, at least in our minds, and to meet with our Savior as he's now on the move in John chapter 4. I want us to encounter him as he has this specific appointment that at first we might see as accidental, but it wasn't. It was a divine appointment for him to impart hope, to show that he was here for hope. It's the story of Jesus meeting the woman at the well. I want you to track with this conversation. We're going to get at least halfway through, then we're going to push pause, and we're going to pick the rest up on Easter next Sunday. Because I thought trying to get through 45 verses would be a little too much, and all of us would like to eat at some point today. So we're going to stop halfway, but we're going to unpack this crucial conversation. So I want you to open up your Bibles with me to John chapter 4. John chapter 4 is found on page 888 in the ESV or in the Bibles that are in front of you. You can also follow along in the Grace Chapel app. If you haven't downloaded it yet, you got to get this. It's a great app. Helps you stay connected to what's happening at Grace. But it also has my sermon notes in there. You can follow along on YouVersion, or I've also put an outline on the back of the bulletin. It's my hope for you. Maybe I should stop using the word hope. It's my desire for you, right? That you would be note takers, that you would pay attention to God's word. So please, we're going to embark on unpacking this very important, very significant conversation. Please, please pay close attention. As you find the passage in John chapter 4, let me remind you of where we left off in John chapter 3. John chapter 3 was this climactic chapter, of which has John 3:16 embedded right in it, that all-famous verse that is kind of the gospel captured for us in a phrase. John chapter 3 ends by saying, the Father loves the Son, in verse 35, and has given all things into his hand. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains in him. These are breathtaking words. The statement here at the end of 3 are powerful things we must get our hearts around, our minds around. It says that the Father loves the Son and has given everything into his hands. God has deemed Christ as the very one who would have all authority. Not part authority, not some authority. We know that Jesus is God from the very first verse in this book, but it's very clear at the end of chapter 3, after the gospel has been explained, that God the Father loves and trusts the Son so much so that he allows Jesus to have all authority. And we see this beautiful story of Jesus having a conversation with Nicodemus in chapter 3. And then we see John and his disciples get jealous over Jesus' rising popularity at the end of chapter 3. And now we move into chapter 4. And the very one who has been given all authority from God is now going to use that authority to give life. He's now going to speak to this woman and tell her about life. And it is only God and only the one who has all authority that can give life. So he uses that authority immediately, right now, only him, no one else, to faithfully communicate that all life comes from him. So let's start with the first six verses. I have written in the margin of my Bible, the journey. I call these six verses the journey. And we're going to look at the journey, the encounter, the offer, the change, all that's going to come next week. But I want us to look at the journey, at least to start. Verses 1 through 6 of John chapter 4 say this. Now, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from the journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. Let's just pause there. We know that Jesus leaves this place that was probably lush. It was probably a great place. He's near Ainon, near Salem, this place where the water is plentiful, it tells us in chapter 3. He's baptizing there in Ainon. He's watching people come down from Jerusalem. It wouldn't have been that far of a walk from Jerusalem. The crowds are mounding to be baptized by him, or if not him, his disciples. They wanted to hear him speak. Maybe they thought they'd get a sermon in with John while they're at it. John's there with his disciples. He's baptizing. His line is waning, but yet he's still being faithful to what God has called him to do. There would have been plenty of water. It would have been a Jewish area, so it would have been safe for a rabbi and his students to hang out. He could have said, this is going to be the capital of my ministry. He could have just camped out there. He could have said, hey, I've already done what I needed to in Cana. I've left Nazareth. I've gone to Jerusalem. I've flipped a few tables. And now I'm going to sit here and make this my ministry headquarters. The temperature was probably great. The scenery was probably beautiful. But it says that he chooses to move on. By the sound of it, the crowds were mounting. Chapter 3 tells us that the line was long for people that were wanting to see or be baptized or made disciples of Jesus. Just as there was growing excitement about Jesus in a positive way, there was growing negative energy about Jesus from the Pharisees. The Pharisees heard about what was happening with Jesus, all these people that wanted to come and be baptized by him, hear from him. The Pharisees were getting more and more edgy, more and more angry. People excited to go see Jesus and Pharisees ready to take him out. You can see there in the passage, it says Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John. He learned, he came to knowledge. Maybe somebody told him, maybe he perceived it, but somehow he knew that now the Pharisees were upset. They had heard that Jesus' popularity was rising, so he bolts out of town. He leaves. It makes sense that we would ask, well, why would Jesus leave his post? It's seemingly a great post. He could have had amazing ministry there. Is he running from the Pharisees? Don't think for one second that Jesus left this place out of fear. We were just told that he has all authority. So the very one who has all authority has no reason to leave because he's afraid. He's not leaving because he's afraid of the Pharisees. Though the Pharisees would eventually be there to take his life, to be part of the killing, Jesus wasn't afraid. Jesus had made it very clear. The hour had not yet come. He knew it was not his time to die. He also said later that no one takes my life from me. I choose to lay my life down. So he was completely in control. He wasn't afraid. I don't want you to think that God ever makes fear a catalyst for his movements. He never is afraid. It could be, though, maybe he's exerting some kind of control. He decides, well, we got to move. The Pharisees are after me. My hour has not yet come. I'm in control of this. It's not going to go well with the Pharisees eventually. So I'm saying, hey, time to move. We got to get out of here. That could be. Another option could be that he thought, this is going to go really bad for my friend John. We know from Matthew chapter 11, Jesus loved John. He says he's one of the greatest men that was ever born of a woman. We were all born of women. So he says he's one of the greatest that's ever come from a woman. He loves John. And he knew that because his popularity was increasing, as the passage says, he learned the Pharisees knew this, or they heard this, he knew that that would get John in trouble. You see, the Pharisees, they didn't like John. I wouldn't exactly say that John liked the Pharisees either. John would stand on the shore, or maybe down in the water, yelling at the Pharisees, "You baptize yourselves! You guys need to repent." He didn't like them. And they didn't like the message he was sending about them, telling other people, don't be like the Pharisees. And so maybe Jesus thought, well, if the Pharisees are upset, they're going to come down here and make it really hard on John because they're going to say, look, your baptism is nothing. Jesus' popularity is growing. People are going to him. Nobody's coming to you. See, everyone, see this crazy man, what is that guy? Bear Gills or Giles or whatever, that guy in the nature that does crazy things. This is him in the prophet form, right? Bear Grill in the prophet form, wearing camel hair, leather belt, eating crazy things. They were just going to point out, look, he's crazy. Maybe Jesus thought it'd go bad for both of them. The Pharisees would disgrace and disown and tell people to turn away from both of them. So he decides to leave. All of those are valid reasons why Jesus may have moved. But I've come to one other conclusion. Maybe some of those things are true, but maybe the reason he moved is told for us exactly in verse 4. It says in verse 4, he had to pass through Samaria. I think Jesus had to move from this beautiful place that should have or could have been a home for his ministry. He had to move because he had an appointment he had to keep. He had an appointment he had to get off to in Samaria. It was time for him to move. Now, I don't want you to think for one moment that when it says something like that, like he had to pass through Samaria, that it had something to do with geological or geographical constraints. Of course, he had to go through. There was no other way. That's not true. In fact, let me show you on a map. Look at this map of Israel. You can see here in the middle of the map, the belly button of Israel, maybe, is right here in the middle where Jesus was baptizing near Salem. Beautiful place, lush place, right on the Jordan Valley. Up here we have the Sea of Galilee. Down below off the screen is the Dead Sea. The Jordan runs from the Sea of Galilee to the Dead Sea. That's it. The headwaters of the Jordan are up above here. It would have easily made sense if he knew he needed to get up to Galilee or he was going to go up there to fulfill the prophecy given to us in Isaiah that his ministry would be there, that he would make great the way by the sea. He knew he had to do that. He had purpose in everything he was doing. But let's say he knew that, he could have just followed the Jordan because eventually it's going to reach the Sea of Galilee because at the top of the Sea of Galilee is the headwaters to the Jordan. So he easily could have just walked the Jordan. It would have made sense to do that. But the other option is you could leave from here and go east, which is now modern day Jordan. You can go east and you can walk all the way around, go through these beautiful cities called the Decapolis, these 10 Roman cities. He could have gone through there, had great places to stay, been welcomed as a Jew, been safe, and gone all the way up to Capernaum or wherever it was that he wanted to land next. That would have been the more natural way. But instead, it says in verse 4 that he had to go to, where did he have to go? Samaria. He had to go. Look at where Samaria is on the map. It was not natural for him to go down here. You can actually see Sychar, Jacob's fountain, is listed for us right there. Samaria, right here, this hill country. He came down and over to go to the place where he had an appointment he could not miss. It wasn't the most natural way for him to go. But God had a purpose. He wasn't going to follow the strict Jewish law of not going through Samaria so that you aren't defiled. It wasn't about Jewish law. It wasn't about finding the easiest path. Jesus never does things the easiest way. It's not about convenience for our Savior. He had purpose in everything that he does and everything he still does. The Bible says he had to go through Samaria. He had to because he had an appointment he had to keep. And his itinerary was subject only to the sovereign and providential plan of God. God had someone for him to be with. In fact, this word "had to" in the original language can be translated, it was necessary or necessary to. And every other place, John, the gospel writer, uses this word, had to. It always is tied to some divine necessity, some divine reason of God. So there was a reason he had to go. He wasn't going to be jerked around by humans' opinions or by what was more preferable or by 12 complaining disciples going, there's a better way. He went as a sovereign savior, the exact way God had for him to go, proving that he had great purpose in everything that he does. Friends, I say to you this morning, everything that our God does is purposeful. He has purpose behind everything he does. And at any given moment, he's doing 10 million things in our life. He's constantly working in our life. He may only tell you, 3, 4, 5 of the reasons behind why or what he is doing in your life. He will not always explain everything to you, but he's constantly working in your life. Millions of things happening in your life at one time. You might know one of them. You might be sitting there going, I know none of them. He's not explaining to me what he's doing. And guess what? He doesn't have to explain to you. But he's absolutely purposeful in everything he does. So in all of the things he's doing in your life, in all of the circumstances, in all of the little things, he's moving with unbelievable purpose. That's why I've described these first 6 verses with this one phrase. Jesus was on a purposeful detour to deliver hope. He was delivering hope to someone who needed it badly. It was all on purpose. He went through Samaria to demonstrate that he was the savior to everyone, to the world. We're going to see that clearly in verse 42 when we eventually get there. He was here to save everyone, Jews, Samaritans, men, women, rich and poor. And I remind you this morning that God doesn't care about what you've done, or if you think you're disqualified, or you think you can't be reached by the gospel, or all the reasons you would list on why you're not good enough for God. He doesn't care about your reasons. His gospel is big enough to reach you no matter what you have done, where you have been, what your background is. He has purpose in everything. And our God never forgets his purposes. He never takes a mulligan on his purposes. He never goes for plan B because his plan A didn't work out. He always is moving forward, always moving ahead. He never meanders in the meaningless, but everything he does with a purpose. Everything he does with a purpose. Say everything with me, ready? Everything he does with a purpose. So Jesus and his disciples, they're traveling through Samaria. They come to this village of Sychar. It's known as Askar as well in the Bible, not NASCAR, okay? Askar. Sychar, it's a real place. You can go there. You can see it today. It's got all these modern buildings built even on top of ancient ruins. You can see some of the ancient ruins that are there, but not many people have unearthed them. But we know it's a real place. And about 3/4 of a mile from there, or 0.7 mile from there, there's this well, Jacob's well. This well exists. It was covered by a Byzantine church, which relates back to the 4th century. They said, this is Jacob's well. We know that. It's been preserved. Many holy sites in Israel are preserved by churches, made gaudy by churches. But hey, we'll just be grateful for the churches and especially the Catholics who have preserved them for us. They're just keeping them nice and safe, right? But this well now sits inside of a church that you can go see. It's a real well. It's a real place. This really happened. Jesus goes off the beaten path to come to this well, Jacob's well, a well that would have been maybe 100 feet deep. And it says in verse 6, he's weary, Jesus is, from the journey. And he's sitting beside the well. If you read this in the original language, it actually is sitting upon the well, on the side of the well. You can't miss him, is basically what John's getting at. He's on the well. And it's about the 6th hour. It's noon. He goes to this place to find water. He's weary. He needed a drink. He arrives with the disciples. They're going through Samaria. He knew where he was going. He's leading them right to a well. We'll get some water when we get there. Stop complaining. We'll get some water when we get there. Finally, they get to the well. Jacob's well. If God does everything on purpose, then I'm going to even believe that it was purposeful that he went to this well of all the wells that he could have chosen. He went to this well that was esteemed because it was in the field that Jacob had given his son Joseph, mentioned to us in Genesis chapter 48. Not far from this well, Joseph's tomb or burial site is commemorated. They said this is significant. It's part of what our fathers gave us. Okay, so track with me for a second. If everything that he does is on purpose, then of all the wells he could have chosen, he chose this well. Why? I believe to make a statement, which will be clear in the passages to come, but to make a statement of, I'm greater than even Jacob. I'm greater than the fathers of Israel, than Joseph. I'm greater than all of them. They're great, but don't be caught on the past. Look what's right before you. Look forward into the future. He said later, I'm greater than Abraham. We know that he's greater than all the fathers of Israel. He's trying so hard to get this message through. He's saying, faithfully look to the God of the present. I'm right before you. He's going to say that to this woman here in a moment. He's fully divine. He's fully in control of God's storyline. He's full of purpose, but he's also fully human. He's thirsty. He comes to this well. We see his human nature peeking through. He's thirsty. He wants some water. It's noon. It's hot. They've been hiking. They've risen in elevation. He'd love nothing more than some water to quench his thirst. And as he gets to this well, we see this encounter that happens. Look at verse 7 through 9 with me. It says, a woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, give me a drink. For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, how is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. I want you to pick up what's happening in the story. There are two main characters. There are other characters, but two main characters and one main relationship. And that is the relationship with Jesus and this woman. The two main characters, woman and Jesus. And in a moment, we're going to see him begin to unleash this relentless grace, just as our God always does. Isn't he so gracious with us? He sees this woman. He should have shunned her, but he didn't shun her. In fact, he never condemns her. He welcomes her into a relationship. Nothing is happening by accident here. He's seeking her salvation. He knows everything about her. That's why I would classify this encounter as a caring exchange to encourage the outcast. This woman is an outcast woman. I find it extremely significant, also purposeful, that Jesus would seek to be alone with a woman who is considered to be an outcast. He's alone. We're told in verse 8 that the disciples had gone to get food for them. All of them went to go get food. It doesn't take 12 guys to go get lunch, okay? It doesn't. Maybe the women are like, yeah, but they don't ask for directions, so probably needs 12 of them. Jesus said, all of you, go get lunch. Peter's like, no, I'll sit here with you. No, Peter, get up and go get lunch. I want all of you to move. No, I'm tired. Go get lunch. All of you move. They leave. He's the only one there. Purpose in everything. He knew this woman was coming. I believe before the beginning of time, he knew this woman was coming. The disciples leave to go find food in a Samaritan town, which would have been hard, by the way, for a bunch of Jews. But they go and they look for food. And then this woman, she starts coming. This woman is now moving to meet Jesus, and he engages with her. He's sitting there alone. You can't miss him. He's not off to the side. He's not lurking behind the side. He's on the well. And he starts to engage with this Samaritan woman. And she thinks it's odd. She even thinks it's weird that he would talk to her. Let's unpack why, from a Jewish perspective, this would have been odd. What were the strikes against this woman at the well? First strike against her, that at least from the Jewish perspective, is that she was a woman. He's talking to a woman. When Jesus' disciples return, in verse 27, they say they were surprised that Jesus was talking to a woman. First century Jewish culture, it would have been odd for a man to talk with a woman, especially not his wife. It just would have been odd. It was not part of the custom, not in the day. That's not how this happened. So that was odd. He's talking with this woman. And not only that, she was a Samaritan. In Jesus' day, there was this incredible hostility between the Jews and the Samaritans, this bitter hostility that existed between them. Even the woman said, "You're a Jew. I'm a Samaritan woman. Why are you talking to me?" The reason for the hostility between the Jews and the Samaritans, it goes way back. It goes back to Assyria capturing these people who would have lived in this Samaritan area, capturing them, taking them away, sending some of their people back to live there. You can read about this in 2 Kings. And now, all of a sudden, they start intermingling. These people that would have once been pure Jewish people living in this area from the tribes all the way of Israel now are intermarrying or intermingling with Assyrian people. They're half-breeds, if you will. That's how they were seen culturally. Not only that, they stopped worshiping only Yahweh, the one true God. They had this worship of many other gods. Eventually that went away. And now they started worshiping one true God. But even when they worshiped one true God, they had this weird kind of belief that the rest of the Bible didn't matter and only the first five books of the Bible mattered. So they discounted the Psalms, they discounted the prophets. And let's just say Jews had lots of reasons to not like the Samaritans. But it goes both ways. The Samaritans were not huge fans of the Jews. The Samaritans had offered to help rebuild the temple after they were back in their land. And the Jews said, "No thanks." You can read about that in Ezra. Well, they're offended. "Why would you not let us help rebuild the temple?" So they build their own temple in Mount Gerizim. They say, "Listen, we don't need you then." And they pull themselves away. There's all sorts of hostility here. If you were to live at this time and call someone a fellow Jew, a Samaritan, it was a very derogatory term. It was to say, "Wow, look at you. You're not obeying the law. You don't hold to one true God. You're a half-breed." It was a very, very offensive term. It was something that was not respected by anyone who called themselves a Jew. Maybe the best way to understand the Samaritan-Jewish conflict is to go back into American history for a moment. Not even that far. Let's go back maybe in the 50s, around the time where, especially in the Deep South, you could walk into Walgreens or Woolworths or something like that, and there'd be two water fountains. There'd be one water fountain that says white, and another water fountain that says colored. And in our pretty recent history, you would have to go to whichever water fountain based on your skin tone. We let our prejudice dictate our plumbing. It would have been odd for a white person to go to a colored fountain, as it were, and to ask for a drink. Think now of this story of the woman in context to what we experienced not that long ago in America. Imagine first century that this is the colored or the Samaritan water well. This is not a place where Jews go to drink. And not only that, when Jesus encounters this woman, he asks for a drink out of, again, using our context and past history, out of what would be considered the colored water fountain. He doesn't just say, give me a drink out of it. He says, listen, let me drink out of your cup. It would have been as if somebody that was white back in the day in the Deep South goes and says to a person drinking out of the colored water fountain, hey, I don't only want to drink out of the fountain, but can I use your water bottle? Can I drink out of your water bottle? That's what's happening here in context. The Jews did not think this way. They had this kind of animosity, this prejudice that was wrong. And Jesus said, listen, I'm not going to let it influence the way I think. So he basically says, let me drink from your cup. Let me have a drink from your cup. And the woman replies, or John takes note, they have no dealing with Samaritans. If you read this in the original language, it literally says, and can be rendered as, they do not share the use of things. But Jesus was purposeful to say, I don't care about your background. I don't care about what might be your race or where you came from. I care about you. I want to share the cup with you. And not only was she a woman, and not only was she a Samaritan, but she was also considered immoral. We're going to learn more about that next week when we study it, but look down at verse 18. It says, he's calling her out. He says, the fact is you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. She's a woman who obviously has had many different men, including the man she's with at the moment. But that didn't stop our sweet Savior. She's walking to the well in the middle of the day. That's odd. Women usually would have gone in the morning or in the evening in the cool of the day. But the immoral women, the outcasts of the culture, they had to walk to the well in the middle of the day. They had to walk in the heat of the day to the well. And she walked in the heat of the midday sun to meet the Son of God who's sitting on the side of the well. It's amazing. Now listen, this passage has been preached hundreds of times as a passage to encourage evangelism. I've even preached this passage as a way to say, we need to be like Jesus. We need to go in and reach the Samaritans. We need to be like Jesus. It's not a bad sermon, but I believe it's a sermon out of context. Listen, the truth is, you and I are not Jesus. You want to know who we are in this story? We're the woman. We're the woman. We're the outcast. We're the sinners. We're the far from God. And yet he comes as a loving Savior with unbelievable purpose to grant us the most gracious offering he can ever give, which is living water through a relationship that only comes through him. We're the woman. This is John's version of the prodigal story that Luke tells us. We're not the father in the prodigal story. We're the son that spends his inheritance out fornicating and finding pleasure in sinful things, and the Father welcomes us back. So in the same way, our sweet Savior says, come close to me, I'm willing to drink out of the same cup as you, adulterous woman. He's gracious in his relationship, and he's gracious with us every single day. The author of this gospel, who's ultimately obviously inspired by God, he builds this beautiful picture of a woman who had sunk below what maybe some would have thought was the reach of salvation. She's too far gone. And he builds a contrast with her in chapter 4 and the highly righteous Nicodemus in chapter 3. Nicodemus obeyed the law perfectly. And yet he still needed to be saved. And this woman was an outcast in her culture, and she still needed to be saved. No matter where we are at, he is the only one who can save us. It doesn't matter how moral you are. It doesn't matter how wretched you are. His grace is the only thing that saves us. Which brings us to the offering that he makes her in verse 10 through 15. After she says, "We can't share a cup." No. He's basically saying, "I want to share something else with you, something even greater with you." Verse 10 says, "Jesus answered her, 'If you knew the gift of God, who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water.' The woman said to him, 'Sir, you have nothing to draw water with and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his son and his livestock.' And Jesus said to her, 'Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life.' And the woman said to him, 'Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water again.'" I call these five verses the offer. What's the offer? The offer is a superior grace to satisfy the soul. He offers her grace, amazing grace, but she misses it. She thinks he's talking about a stream, living water, moving water. Where's this water so that I can drink of it so I don't have to keep coming to the well? This is hot. I don't like it. She misses it. Nicodemus missed it too. Jesus said, "You have to be born again." Well, show me a woman big enough with a stomach big enough that I can crawl back in. They missed it. He's talking about living water, amazing water. There's similarities between physical water and spiritual water, many similarities. Water is necessary for life. Salvation is necessary for spiritual life. Water comes from above. Salvation comes from above, only from God. Water refreshes, it satisfies. Salvation also satisfies. He offers her something greater than water. And all she says is, "Where's your bucket?" And don't we do the same exact thing? That our Savior says to us, "I have something for you. I have living water for you. I have salvation for you." And we just miss it. Well, where's your bucket? Because my desires are overwhelming. My flesh tells me I need this thing or that thing. My friends influence me to think I must pursue this. The world tells me this. And yet he stands there going, "I got living water for you." The NLT translates this passage as bubbling up water. It could be looked at in the original language as leaping water, water that doesn't stop giving for every desire in your life. You can find satisfaction in Jesus Christ, and yet we still say, "Well, where's your bucket?" Physical water, it only satisfies for a short time. But the salvation water that Jesus offers us permanently satisfies our soul. It's said of Christ in Revelation chapter 22, verse 17, "Whoever is thirsty, let him come. Whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of water of life," the water of life. Friends, I close with this. The water Jesus offers you is from God. Verse 10 makes it clear, this is from God. Nothing else in this life will satisfy you the way that God can satisfy you. The water Jesus offers you is living water. It's salvation from sin's bondage and condemnation in your life. It's living water. It sets you free from the sin in your life. For freedom, Christ has come to set us free. The water Jesus offers us, if you drink of it, you'll never thirst again. What does that mean? Does it mean that I won't have any desires anymore? Because that's not true. I have desires all the time. No, you will have desires. But you can run back to this stream every single time and know that it will satisfy your deepest desires. The water Jesus offers you is eternal life. It's eternal life now. It's his presence divinely joined with your life now. Now. There's nothing like the living water. We're not going to finish this story today. We're going to look at the rest of it next week. But you don't have to know the rest of this story to make a decision. What you need to know is that our Savior is enough. This Savior, Jesus Christ, has offered to satisfy your soul. He's enough. And Christian, if you believe in Jesus Christ, I say to you clearly, you need to look to him to fully satisfy you. If you're walking around spiritually dehydrated, then you have not come to the place of understanding that the salvation of Christ will satisfy your soul completely. Spiritual dehydration is cured by coming to this place to say that Jesus is enough, the gospel is enough. So is your heart dry? Are you weary? It's time to wash over your soul with the gospel, time and again, time and again. And I say to you this morning, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're not going to find another well, another living spring that will give you the kind of satisfaction my Jesus will give you. And no matter where you're looking and no matter where you're searching, I can say to you this morning, your search can be over if you will just put your faith in Jesus Christ. Allow him to be enough for you. Allow him to be enough for you. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, holy God in heaven, we thank you for sending your son who is always enough. We thank you that he would go with purpose to meet with an outcast. And all of us have fallen short of your glory, so therefore we too are outcasts, and thank you for allowing him to meet with us. Father, I pray that you will help us be people who are fully dependent upon you, believing that your salvation for our soul is enough. And that the living water, the refreshing water of the gospel will wash over us this week, that we will be refreshed by the truth that our Savior came, that he died, and that he rose again. May this Easter week be a week where our souls are filled to the brim. Thank you for being willing to drink of our cup with us, for accepting us. Not based on our own righteousness, but based on your unconditional love. It's in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.